Hello everyone, welcome to Bhadra IAS Academy. Today we're going to start a topic on this very important subject known as art and culture. Now, art and culture is a very important topic both for UPSC preliminary examination as well as general studies paper 1. So for both prelims and mains point of view, this is a very important subject. So today we'll be starting from Indian architecture. So Indian architecture can be basically divided into three major phases: the ancient, the medieval, and the modern phase. In the ancient phase, we can divide it, further subdivided it into the Harappan architecture, the architecture during the Mauryan age, then the post-Mauryan age, followed by the Gupta age, and then finally the South Indian art and architecture. So today we'll start with Harappan architecture. So the Harappan age is roughly around from 2800 BC to 1750 BC. So in this period, the Harappan civilization developed remarkable architecture, and we'll study about it. So please write down the main features of the Harappan architecture was the remarkable town planning, the different kinds of buildings, the division of the towns into various groups. So you can note down the features of the Harappan architecture. The first and the most important feature of Harappan architecture is the remarkable urban town planning. So remarkable urban town planning is one of the most striking features of Harappan architecture and Harappan civilization as well. So in the Harappan civilization, the towns were divided into various blocks in grid pattern, okay, also known as the chessboard pattern. Chessboard pattern, like a chessboard. So suppose this is the entire town, so it will be divided into various blocks similar to a chessboard. So another feature was that the roads used to cut each other at right angles, as you can see. So the roads were constructed at right angles to each other, and the city was divided into various blocks. Okay, another important feature was the use of burnt mud bricks. So this is the main material with which the various buildings were constructed: the burnt mud bricks and gypsum mortar. So this is the main material. Okay, the next point is the different types of buildings. So what are the different types of buildings that are found in the Harappan civilization? So mainly we can find three types of buildings. First type is the private houses. Second one are public buildings. And the third kind of buildings was public baths. Okay, so generally we find three kinds of buildings. Okay. So another feature of the Harappan architecture or Harappan civilization was that the city was divided, the cities were divided into two major blocks. The citadel, also known as the upper town, and the lower town. Okay, the citadels or the upper town, as the name suggests, was built in a raised platform, and it used to house the various important buildings, the public buildings and houses of important persons, okay, important officials. And the lower town was for the common people. They had their houses in the lower town. Okay, so after this, another important type of building, as we already mentioned here, are the public baths. So the public baths were generally used for ritualistic cleansing. So normally, even in today's time also, so we go to various religious places and take baths over there. So similar kind of activity was also followed by the Harappan civilization. So for this, they had public baths. So one of the important public baths was the Great Bath at Mohenjo-daro. So this was one of the important public baths which was constructed during the Harappan age. Okay. Since it was an urban civilization, so the urban features were also present in all the houses. So most house used to have private wells, then private bathrooms, and drains. Another important feature that is remarkable about this civilization was the efficient drainage system. So the drainage system of Harappan urban centers was very, very efficient. Smaller drains used to collect the sewage from private houses, and they used to be gathered in the larger drains, and then they were taken out of the city. So these drains were also regularly cleaned so that the drains do not get blocked in any way. So these are the main general features of the Harappan architecture. Also, one of the important remarkable feature was the absence of, you can write down, absence of religious buildings. In Harappan towns, we do not find any major temple or any kind of structure that suggests that it is a part of a religious purpose. So this suggests that the Harappan civilization was secular in nature and religion was a private affair. Okay. So with this, we come to an end of the first part of today's lecture, that is the Harappan civilization. So after the Harappan civilization, as we know, it was followed by the Vedic age and the age of the Mahajanapadas. So in these two major phases, what happened was that there was not much of constructional activity, because the kingdoms were basically, or the civilization was basically rural in nature. So we don't have much proof of any kind of architecture of these two phases. Okay. So the next major phase is the Mauryan phase. So Mauryan architecture, as we know, the time period is roughly around 300 BC to 200 BC. Okay, so in the Mauryan age, we generally find two types of buildings or two kinds of architecture. So the first type is known as the court architecture, okay, and the second type is known as the popular architecture. So the main difference between this court architecture and popular architecture is that the court architecture was directly patronized by the kings, okay, and the governors, the various governors. So they used to provide the funding and various other elements that are necessary to build these buildings. So what kind of buildings we find under court architecture, please note down. First of all, palaces. Then we have pillars. Okay. And finally, stupas. So these three are the main types of buildings under the court architecture. Under popular architecture, we find caves. So generally, the various kinds of monks used to construct or used to carve caves in various rocks for residential and religious purposes as well. Okay, so these are the main kinds of buildings that are found in the Mauryan architecture. So we'll start with the palaces. That is the first kind of buildings that are found in the Mauryan phase. So please write down palaces. So the main cause of the emergence of architecture at such a large scale was that the stability of the empire, which implied that there was huge availability of resources. And another cause was the institutionalization of religion. That is the main, that these two are the main reasons why the there was so much of architectural activities during this period of time. Okay, so coming to palaces, the Mauryan age was the beginning of stone masonry or monumental stone architecture in India. So you can write down introduction of stone masonry at large scale. Okay. Okay. So, two major palaces are found in this time period. You can write down. The first one is the Palace of Chandragupta Maurya. This is in Pataliputra. And the second palace is Palace of Ashoka at Kumbhar. So these are two important palaces of that time period. Okay. Now, the Palace of Chandragupta Maurya was basically made of wood. It was a wooden palace, and it was inspired by the Achaemenid pillars, sorry, Achaemenid palaces of the Persian Empire. Okay, Megasthenes described the palace as one of the greatest creations of mankind. Okay, so that is a very important structure of this time period. Now, coming to Ashoka's palace at Kumbhar. It was discovered by D.B. Spooner and K.P. Jaiswal. So this palace was having 80 pillars. Okay. And it was made of a particular kind of stone known as Chunar sandstone. Okay. Another feature of this palace was that it was polished. Okay. And it was having buff color, means brownish. The color was brownish in nature. Okay, these are the main features of this palace. Another important information regarding the Palace of Ashoka is that the Third Buddhist Council which was held at Pataliputra was held in this very palace. It is said that. Okay. So this is whatever we know about the palaces of that time period. Now, the next topic that we'll be moving to is the pillars. Okay. Pillars during modern age. Now, why pillars are such an important structure that we have to study it. The main reason was that although the pillars, there are actually pillars, the main purpose was to support a building, okay, right? To support the roof of a building, the pillars are used. But in Mauryan Empire, the pillars were used for other purposes as well, which is a very unique feature of this modern architecture. Okay, so if we look at the causes why the pillars were built, so first of all, to support the roofs, which is the usual reason why pillars are made. Secondly, it was used as a symbol of Axis Mundi. We'll come to this in a short while. The third reason was as a means of commemoration of battle victories. And the fourth reason is that use of the pillars as state symbols. Another unique reason was the propagation of Dhamma. So this particular reason evolved during the reign of Ashoka, and he used the pillars for propagating the various ideas of Dhamma, right? Okay, now coming to this thing called Axis Mundi. So Axis Mundi is basically a structure, that a tall structure generally, which is considered as the axis of the earth. So any tall structure, could be a pillar, it could be even natural structure, for example mountains, etc. So generally people believe that this is the position where the earth ends and the heavens will start from here. Okay, this is the point. So to signify that structure, the various pillars were constructed. Okay, then coming to battle victories, whenever there was a battle victory, the kings would construct pillars to say that this is a part of our kingdom. And state symbols as for various kinds of communication, to say something to the people, whatever messages that the kings would want to give to its subject. So these are the main reasons why the pillars were constructed. Okay. Okay. Now, you can write down some more features. During Chandragupta Maurya, I'm writing it in short form, the pillars were generally made of wood. Okay, wooden pillars. During Ashoka, the main material was stone. Okay. So as I already said, there are two kinds of pillars. If we can classify them according to their uses: freestanding and palace pillars. So the freestanding pillars were those pillars which would not support anything. It stood by itself. But the palace pillars were used as a part of the palace for, you know, architectural purpose. Okay. So these pillars were generally constructed at two places. The first one is Mathura, and the second one is Chunar. So these are the two main places from which, at which these pillars were constructed. And after the construction was over, these palace, these pillars were carried or transported to various places all over the kingdom, and then they were erected accordingly. Okay. So. Okay. So we can have a look at the features, the general features of the pillars. Okay. You can draw this diagram, which will give us the general overview of a modern pillar. Okay. So generally, the pillars used to have this kind of a structure. Okay. So the top structure is known as the crown or capital. Okay, this rectangular base that you can see here, this is known as the abacus. Then we have a bell shaped portion here. This is the bell shaped portion. And finally, this monolithic shaft. Okay. Okay. So this is the general structure of an Ashokan or Mauryan pillar. So we can discuss these various parts in details. So first is the monolithic shaft. Now why is it called monolithic? First, the reason was that it was made out of a single piece of stone or rock. Okay, so there it's not like it's not joined with anything. Okay, they will take a big piece of rock and then will carve the entire shaft out of it. Okay, so this monolithic shaft was generally tapering, that is the radius would gradually decrease as we move to the top. So it is something like this. So the radius at the bottom and the radius at the top would be different. The bottom, the radius or diameter will be larger than the one at the top. Okay. The bell capital generally used to have different kind of images, and all these images had different meanings. For example, let me write down here. So the images were generally of lion, then there were flowers, like different flowers, then bull, horses, and such other figures. All these figures, different figures had different kind of meanings. Okay. Now the abacus was the rectangular or circular base and followed by the capital. Okay. And all these parts were then joined to each other using copper balls. Okay, so this is how the Ashokan pillar was made. Fine. Okay. Now, there is a kind of debate or controversy among various historians, some of which suggest that the modern pillars or the Ashokan pillars were indigenous. That is that they were not inspired or copied from anyone. But there are another group of historians who suggest that these pillars were copied or inspired from the Persian pillars or the Achaemenian pillars. Okay. Now, we can see both these sides have their arguments. So, why it is said that Mauryan and Persian pillars, you know, Mauryan pillars are copied from Persian pillars? So, there are various reasons. Okay. See, basically, there has been several similarities between these two kinds of pillars. So that is why the colonial historians, that is the British historians generally, suggested that these were inspired from the Persian pillars. For example, the use of stone, okay, then the features such as abacus, then the capital, that is the crowning animal, the glossy finish, both pillars used to have glossy finish. So these are the features that were found in both Ashokan as well as Persian pillars. So that is what a colonial historian suggested, that the Mauryans actually copied or took the idea from the Persian pillars. But at the same time, there are several differences. If we have a closer look, you will see that there are several differences. So, what are the differences between Ashokan and Persian pillars? Ashokan or Mauryan pillars? So, you can just note it down, some of the differences between Ashokan and Persian pillars. So, the first difference is the use of a monolithic shaft. We have already discussed that Ashokan pillars or Mauryan pillars were made of a single piece of stone, I mean the shaft. But in Persian pillars, it was not monolithic. Okay, several parts were joined together using some kind of joining element, and then those were created. They were not carved out of a single piece of rock. So that is one important difference. Now, second difference is that tapering. The shaft in Mauryan pillars used to taper as we move to the top, but in Persian pillars, they were always cylindrical. Okay? The existence of freestanding pillar is a unique feature which is not found in the Persian pillars. The Persian pillars are always part of palaces. Okay, they are always palace pillars. They are not, you will not find individual pillars, you know, which are not part of a palace. Okay, then the next difference is that in Ashokan pillars there was no base, but Persian pillars were laid on some kind of base. Let me explain it. So suppose this is the ground. If it is an Ashokan pillar, then it will be erected directly. Okay. But there will be nothing here at the base level. It is not, there is nothing, no extra base or something. But in Persian pillars, there are capitals, there are bases at the bottom also. Okay, so that is a unique difference between the Ashokan and Persian pillars. Another important difference between both Ashokan and Persian pillar was that absence of capital on palace pillars. But in Persian pillars, we find that even the palace pillars used to have capitals. For example, suppose this is the roof. In an Ashokan pillar, you won't find anything between the roof and the pillar, but it is simply like this. But in Persian palaces, even the palace pillars will have capitals. So that is an important point of difference. Another important, very important point of difference is that use of palace for the propagation or preaching of Dhamma. Now this is something that Ashoka did in all his in his various pillars. He used to inscribe his edicts, what he used to communicate, what he tried to communicate with his subjects. The elements of Dhamma were inscribed in this palace. But in Persian, we don't find any such use, except for its use as parts of palaces. There is no such use that is found between Ashokan and Persian pillars. So, with this, we can conclude that although there are some similarities between Persian as well as Ashokan pillars, but this cannot be considered as any, you cannot say that Ashokan pillars were directly copied. So some features will always be there, but these unique features of differences that we just discussed will prove that it is not a case of alien grafting. Okay? So, with this, we come to an end of the Ashokan pillars or the Mauryan pillars. So, this is about the pillars and palaces of modern age. In the next classes, we'll discuss the other features, the stupas and the other different kinds of structures, the caves, and then we'll move on to the move on to the next phase in the history, that is the post-Mauryan and then the Gupta age. Okay, so thank you very much. Thank you.